Hello, and welcome to Aviation Deep Dive. One of the least known patrol aircraft of the Second World War, and yet simultaneously one of the most successful, the PBM Mariner was a behemoth of an aircraft in both scale, at 80 feet long, and performance. Yet it's lived consistently in the shadow of its smaller and older counterpart, the PBY Catalina. Designed to complement the Catalina in service, the Mariner was in fact better in a great many aspects, though ultimately would be built in far smaller numbers. To better understand the roots of this fascinating American giant, however, we must head back to 1937. US aircraft companies Martin and Consolidated had spent the better part of the early 1930s fiercely competing for aircraft contracts, both trying to build flying boat designs and Navy specifications, though by 1934 Consolidated had essentially secured its place as the favorite, so Martin had to look elsewhere to secure orders. Briefly delving into the civilian aircraft market and producing the striking Martin M130, it would ultimately be turned down by Pan American Airways in favor of the superior Boeing 314. Martin's failure to secure contracts was more of a circumstantial matter of luck, rather than being indicative of any issues with the company's capabilities. The aircraft they had been producing were, in their own right, excellent, but competition was extremely stiff. It was the golden age of aviation, and many companies were coming into their prime, especially in the sphere of seaplanes. Begrudgingly, Martin turned back towards flying boats for military applications, with nowhere else to turn. In 1936, when a new Navy specification came through, however, Martin's engineers immediately set to work. The aircraft would of course need to be a flying boat, with excellent range, endurance, and handling characteristics, whilst also having the facilities to house a fairly large crew for extended operations. By 1937, a design had begun to take shape, designated the Model 162, and was intended to be a direct successor of Martin's P3M, which had been in service since the late 1920s. With over a decade of technological advancement and experience under their belt, the 162 was by contrast a thoroughly modern design, featuring a large, capacious, and sloping hull, with striking gull wings, and to be powered by two large radials. The aircraft was also fitted with a generous assortment of turrets to defend the bomber, all intended to be armed with 12.7mm M2 Browning machine guns. The design was certainly impressive, but presumably to Martin's relief, the Navy showed immediate interest and ordered a single prototype be produced, despite the fact that one hadn't even been built yet. Perhaps hinting at how desperate the Navy was to get their hands on this innovative new design. In the interest of saving resources and speeding up development, it was decided to produce a small 3/8 size model to test flying characteristics before committing to building a full-scale one. This was, to a large extent, indicative of the financial issues that Martin was starting to go through. Having difficulty securing contracts, and of course being in the middle of the Great Depression, the company simply couldn't afford to build a huge 80-foot-long aircraft without a guarantee of selling it. So a small-scale model to test out the flying performance was really the only avenue available to them. This 3/8 model, designated the Martin 162A Tadpole Clipper, was to be crewed by a single man, whilst the two propellers would be driven by a 120-horsepower Chevrolet engine connected to the two outboard propellers with belts. Ready for its first test flight in December of 1937, the small hull smoothly broke contact with the water and took off. As Martin had hoped, the model was stable, easy to fly, and had forgiving handling characteristics. This only served to confirm officials' confidence in the design, and so construction went ahead to produce the first full-size aircraft. 15 tons of steel later, in 1939, the first prototype was completed, designated XPBM-1. The aircraft was, aerodynamically and hydrodynamically, more advanced than the Catalina, which by this time had somewhat set the bar for American flying boat designs. Advancements in the understanding of both these fields allowed the hull design to accommodate less drag and better handling, both of which were crucial, as in pure size she would dwarf many ships. She would be powered by engines on the frontier of development, twin Wright R2600 Cyclone radial engines with 14 cylinders and producing 1600 horsepower each. A huge amount of power, but necessary to lift the enormous aircraft into the sky. The XPBM would fly on the 18th of February 1939, and upon leaving the water and doing some testing, general flight characteristics were as expected from data extrapolated from the 3/8 model, with one notable exception. The design of the empennage proved to be problematic, as in flight it experienced intense tail flutter, which made control during certain elements of flight very difficult, and of course, dangerous. After some revisions, Martin kept the attachment point of the tail the same, but slanted it at a significant angle to give a level of dihedral that matched the inner gull wings, and of course gave the aircraft its now iconic look. Another fascinating design choice of the aircraft was that it would have both bomb bays located in the enormous engine nacelles. While most other flying boat designs opt to have their payload externally mounted, this feature would allow for significantly less drag, more speed and range, and potentially a higher carrying capacity. Sold on the design, the United States Navy had already placed an order for 20 of these aircraft even before the first flight. The first production Mariner, designated PBM-1, would begin to equip US Navy squadrons in September 1940. The aircraft, at 4 feet long, 118 feet in span, and 27 feet tall, was without a doubt a giant of an aircraft. It was also protected by an array of 8 50 cal machine guns in nose, dorsal, and tail turrets, along with 2 in side blisters. Carrying up to 4,000 pounds of ordnance, up to 2,600 nautical miles, with a maximum takeoff weight of 25 tons, the Mariner was essentially a top performer for its class in every category. In its initial service life before being dragged into the war, Mariners, along with Catalinas, would undertake what were called neutrality patrols over Atlantic sea lanes, where their excellent range and very long flight time necessitated some interesting design features not often considered on combat aircraft. Staying airborne for up to 14 hours at a time, the Mariners were equipped with sleeping quarters, which consisted of 4 bunks and a full kitchen complete with a stove and pantry for preparing meals. Crews often commented that it often felt more like serving on a ship than an aircraft. Immediately following Japan's attack on Pearl Harbor, the Mariners found themselves in a new chapter of their history, and set about proving their worth in combat too. They were used as anti-submarine aircraft initially, undertaking vast patrols of the Atlantic and Pacific in search of enemy vessels. Their first kill would be against a German U-boat on the 30th of June 1942. Throughout the rest of the war, Mariners would be credited with the sinking of 10 U-boats. This new role, however, meant that even the PBM-1's enormous range could be a limiting factor for the endurance of the aircraft, especially considering that Mariner crews could be self-sufficient for days at a time. The PBM-1 also had another issue that needed resolving. The retractable floats, although excellent for reducing drag, proved to not be strong enough to withstand landings at sea, and would occasionally break off. This prompted Martin to begin development of the PBM-2, which would ditch retractable floats for stronger, fixed-position versions, as well as increasing the internal fuel capacity by almost 75%. Modifying a single PBM-1 to this new version, the range was extended to an incredible 4,000 miles, though ultimately only one would be produced and kept by Martin as a testbed until 1944. An update was still considered necessary, however, so when Martin proposed a PBM-3 in the fall of 1940, the Navy ordered 379 immediately, going to show how popular the Mariner was becoming. The government too financed the construction of a new Martin plant so they could increase their output. The main difference was that the new 3 variant had operated Wright Cyclones producing 1700 horsepower fixed and strengthened wing floats, and extended nacelle bomb bays to further increase the carrying capacity to an astonishing 8,000 pounds, more than early B-17s. Other changes included new powered nose and dorsal turrets, and revised beam positions. The first few PBM-3s retained the original three-bladed propeller, but production quickly changed to a four-bladed propeller when it was discovered that it improved performance considerably. A number of PBMs were in fact sent to Britain for evaluation, designated the Mariner GR Mark I, but upon testing, the British concluded that the controls were too heavy and tiring to use for long patrol flights, and ultimately never operationally used them. The Americans, however, would use them extensively, with a number of sub-variants for specific tasks. Seeing a lot of combat in the Atlantic, and continuing to sink U-boats, the Mariners would also play an important role during the Battle of Saipan, when a seaplane base was set up after the island's capture. One particularly incredible story from a Dash 3 variant came in the spring of 1944, when Commander Scott Fitzgerald was ferrying one over Arizona when it suffered an engine failure. Considering it unsafe to continue and without any water nearby, Fitzgerald landed the aircraft on Wilcox Dry Lake, and aside from scraping on the underside of the hull, it was completely undamaged. The Mariner was then stripped of non-essential equipment to lighten the load, fitted with specialized beaching gear, turned into the wind, and managed to take off, making it to San Diego with no further trouble. This particular machine was from then on known as the Mirage of Wilcox Dry Lake. Later in the war, in the Pacific, the Mariners would continue to prove their worth. On March 4, 1945, a Mariner piloted by Jack Christopher would find 8 survivors from a shot-down B-29 at sea. The waves, however, were too rough to land in safely, so the crew dropped smoke lights and life rafts for the downed airmen, while circling above for 6 hours, well into the night, until a ship came and rescued the men. The PBM could also be found often engaged in convoy attacks, where its enormous 8,000-pound payload could be put to good use against Japanese shipping. By the time the end of the war had rolled around, the Mariner had an excellent combat record, and at the time was considered as highly as the now much more famous Catalina. Development did continue in the post-war, with the PBM-5 featuring more powerful Pratt & Whitney R2800-34 radials, producing up to 2100 horsepower, along with the capability to mount rockets for rocket-assisted takeoff. The ultimate variant would be the PBM-5A, which was an amphibious variant featuring tricycle landing gear. These aircraft would continue to serve well into the Korean War, used as long-range maritime patrol platform. In this role, it would continue until eventually being superseded by newer designs such as the P-5M Marlin. The last US squadron retired its Mariners in 1956, after a 16-year service life. The PBM would have some success as an export design too, with Argentina operating 9 during the 1950s, Australia, Netherlands, and Uruguay also having used the aircraft, though ultimately Uruguay would be the last to retire the type for military use in 1964. Generally, however, the aircraft's reputation would begin to fade following the early 1940s, and the smaller Catalina began to eclipse it in public memory. This wasn't helped by a number of high-profile accidents involving the Mariner in the post-war years, where it began to quite unfairly garner a reputation as a widowmaker. Further cementing this legacy was the fact that one of the most famous events involving a Mariner was when a PBM-5 from US Navy Squadron Training No. 49 disappeared whilst trying to search for the infamous missing Flight 19, which I will likely cover in another video. Its entire 13-man crew was lost, and it became a famous event in itself, while the Catalina suffered no such PR issues following the war. Ultimately, only one PBM Mariner survives today, out of a total production run of 1,366, a PBM-5A amphibious model which currently resides at the Pima Air and Space Museum in Tucson, Arizona. However, the original 3/8 scale model designed to test the aircraft has also rather surprisingly survived, and is on display at the Baltimore Museum of Industry. The PBM Mariner was an excellent aircraft, designed at a crucial time to allow Martin as a company to survive. A legend of its day and contemporary of the Catalina, it's unfortunately now faded into comparative obscurity and is often relegated to a simple footnote. Nevertheless, the aircraft was reliable, liked by its crews, and had excellent performance, serving around the world for as long as a quarter of a century after its first flight in some cases. The Mariner has well and truly earned its place in aviation history as a classic aircraft and an American legend. Thank you so much for watching this video of Aviation Deep Dive. Consider liking and subscribing for more weekly content, and please also consider supporting us on Patreon. See you in the skies.